you very much for having me here. We decided on a very general theme when we met, gender, patriarchy and feminism, because I wanted to think a little bit more about the specific theme that I wanted to address. So today my talk is actually on feminism, nationalism and war, which I think is an extremely appropriate thing to talk about at this moment. So what I intend to do in this talk is to present the ways in which feminists think about war and nationalism and the nation state globally. And of course, when you talk about feminism and war, the very first voice that is heard, or the very first voice that one thinks of, is that of Virginia Woolf, who in 1938, in her essay, Three Guineas, made this following very famous statement: as a woman, I have no country. As a woman, I want no country. As a woman, my country is the whole world. Now, this essay, The Three Guineas, explored the interconnection of patriarchal tyranny and fascist tyranny. And in this essay, she hoped that education in women's colleges would produce a generation of women who would be able to end the war. So the analysis may not go in the direction that many feminists today would intend, but nevertheless, at its time, it was a very path-breaking essay, and it was used by anti-fascist and peace campaigners extensively. More than a century later, you have in 2016 Gurmeel Kaur, who, as part of a peace campaign, and this you all know, she held up a placard that said, "Pakistan did not kill my dad, war killed him," which was apparently completely mystifying and incomprehensible to cricketers, to ministers of this government, who had never ever heard such an idea, and they thought she was just completely stupid, because they had never conceptualized war as something apart from nation states. In other words, the cricketers, the very famous cricketers, and the not so famous ministers of this government who ridiculed and mocked her, actually had completely naturalized the idea that by accident of birth you are born into one place, and by that accident of birth you must hate everybody born in another place. And this comes completely natural to you. And today, for example, when Sidhu says you cannot, a former cricketer who is apparently not in the gang of those who have absolutely no sense, when he said that you cannot blame a whole country for the acts of a few, you know the kind of furor that arose. When it seems to me it's almost like a factual statement. It's just a simple, factual, empirical statement. You cannot blame 700 million people for something that a few thousand people do. So what Gurmeel Kaur was, of course, doing was exhibiting a feminist sensibility that refuses to be bound by narrow nationalist barbed wire fences. So we actually have two strands of feminist thought on this. One is feminist anti-militarism, and the other one, which is a little more accessible and easier to relate to, perhaps. But there's also a larger feminist critique of the nation state as such, and that is more difficult possible to relate to. But let us look at each of these in turn. Now, when you look at feminist anti-militarism, you have actually a very interesting field of thought within international relations. You have scholars like Carol Cohn and Sarah Ruddick and others who have looked at how conceptions of masculinity have shaped foreign policy, state identity, and the entire discourse around security and armament during and outside war. So you actually find a very powerful masculinist discourse around war and the armaments industry and the security industry. The images are very phallic, of phallic bombs, phallic fighter jets. It's all very masculinist. There's a whole kind of discourse of 56 inch ki chhati just circulating around discourse on any kind of war. And feminist IR theorists have shown how relations of power are themselves gendered in such a way that the stronger power is assigned a masculinized identity, while concepts such as emotion are seen as indications of weakness and associated with femininity. And in this way, the military strength of a nation and the capability of a nation becomes associated with its degree of masculinity. Talk of disarmament and peace are seen as emasculating. Consequently, militarism becomes normalized. It becomes impossible to challenge a certain discourse of militarism because it has become so naturalized and normalized. And of course, feminist opposition to militarism stems partly from the a question of effectivity, and you don't have to be a feminist to question that, whether war achieves peace, whether war achieves the goals that it claims to achieve, the war to end all wars, the war to bring about peace. So that you don't have to be a feminist to question whether war actually does that, whether war actually is effective. Of course, there are other questions about the costs around militarism. I'll come to that. But the other key distinction that feminist international relations scholars make is between two notions of security, and this is also crucial, which is the idea of security of the nation state, which is assumed to be some kind of individual actor with its own rationale, the way where we say India's interests lie in, or India needs to do. You find a lot of people writing like this in op-ed articles and so on. A lot of serious international relations scholars write like this. The interests of the US, the interests of India, the interests of Pakistan. So there's assumed to be the interest of an entire nation state, which is seen as one homogeneous individual with its own rational interests, which is of course not true, because there is no such thing as India's interests lie in, because India or any nation state is extremely heterogeneous, and usually when you define the interests of a nation in that way, you're defining it in terms of the power elite of that nation. So security of nation states versus the security of people and populations, and not surprisingly, the two don't often match. The security of the nation state lies in war, the security of populations and people lies in peace. Simply, very simply. So there is that kind of a distinction which is very important, and I'll leave that point there for now, but it'll, I think, come up again and again. Now it's important to note that feminist anti-militarism does not invoke biology or the inherently peaceful nature of women. That's not what feminist IR does. There is a kind of scholarship which talks about women as inherently peacemakers and so on, but that is not the way in which feminist scholarship works. And Cynthia Coburn, who is a very important scholar in this field, I'm just going to quote her. She says why she does not mean to invoke biology or the inherently peaceful nature of women, or why feminists don't do that, she says, I quote her, is that feminists have seen too many women soldiers, abusive mothers, and belligerent women political leaders to think that either nature or nurture can guarantee an anti-war impulse in women. Besides, to believe the best of women is to believe the worst of men, that they are irredeemably violence prone. If women really believed that human beings are dichotomous and fixed in their natures, they would see no sense in campaigning for change. So anti-war activists are necessarily social constructionists. So this is what Cynthia Coburn says. So anti-war feminism thus links the way in which women are oppressed and exploited and objectified through our bodies, our sexuality, and our reproductive capacities. And what they do is they demonstrate that war dramatically enhances male authority. Wartime enhances male authority, enhances patriarchal authority, and this is what Virginia Woolf sensed when she wrote Three Guineas, and she linked patriarchal aggression to fascist aggression, because war dramatically does that. War empowers masculinity, and it exacerbates the sexual, and apart from enhancing masculinity as a—I mean—in a discursive way, it also it empirically produces conditions in which women suffer, because sexual violence is often enhanced during wartime. Prostitution and trafficking are frequent side, that is, involuntary prostitution and trafficking are often frequent side effects of militarization. So anti-militarist and anti-war feminism goes far beyond the gender system. It is critical of capitalism, which is often the basis of wars. I mean, when America drops bombs all over West Asia, supposedly to protect the rights of women, everyone knows it's the oil, stupid. Right? Everyone knows that. This is not my phrase, it's a very common phrase. Feminists know that capitalism and economic exploitation and the competition for global resources, what was World War I, what was World War II, what are the continuing wars that the US fights still today, supposedly defending US borders, but actually controlling oil resources of West Asia, where hundreds and hundreds of young Americans are dying there, you don't have the same kind of outrage as Vietnam produced for one reason, that there is no longer compulsory military conscription in the USA. If there was compulsory military conscription in the USA, as there was during Vietnam, every child over 18 of every home would be in that war. But now, only those people are in the army who have no other option. They get to go to college because they joined the army. The poor, a large number of poor people, non-white people, who get to go to college, whose families get looked after. And so they're voluntarily in the war because they're voluntarily in the army, because that's the way they get to have access to a life that they would not otherwise have had. So the moment you end compulsory military conscription, although there have been very, very strong protests about the war in the US, and I'll come back to that. So I'm saying that feminist anti-militarism and anti-war is about recognizing capitalism as the source of wars, and also recognizing that war is always produced by politicizing different kinds of difference, national identity difference, religion, ethnicity, and you can see that all over the globe today. This is not something I need to explain, the way in which war is justified through producing and reproducing these kinds of difference and producing certain kinds of people as hateable and other kinds of people as permanently pure. So feminist anti-militarism also asks who actually end up going to fight wars, as I hinted at a moment ago. Who actually goes to fight those wars? Who goes to die in those wars? Who are cannon fodder, which is the term that is used? The poor, the working class, the immigrants. What are their working conditions? We know about Tej Bahadur Yadav, the BSF soldier, who complained about the food that they get. And to this day, I am confused about what has happened to him, because it is claimed that he has not been punished, but his family claims he has been punished. Has he been dismissed? You will find innumerable speculations on the web. But he was definitely not rewarded for speaking the truth about the conditions under which poor men go to war and die. What happens to the Dalits in the army? The CRPF soldier Veer Singh, a Dalit, who died in Kashmir in 2016, he was refused cremation in his village in Western UP by upper castes. He was not nationalist enough because he was a Dalit. He died, but it just wasn't good enough for them, and they refused to let him be cremated there. And his family still lives in one room with a tin roof. In September 2017, there was a viral video by Jadhav Kamlesh Kumar, another Dalit Jawan of 26 Rashtriya Rifles, who was on one occasion, he spoke about this in the video, on one occasion he was thrown out of the dining room by an officer who refused to eat with the Dalits, recognizing him. He must be having to eat with Dalits on other occasions, but on this occasion he recognized him and threw him out. So who goes to war? That's what feminist militarists ask, anti-militarists ask. Feminist anti-militarists and anti-war scholars also ask who benefits from enhanced budgets for defense, the corporations, the arms dealers. There is enough scholarship to show the very clear link, the clear in unquestionable link between aggressive marketing strategies by defense companies in countries that produce arms and the foreign policies of those countries that link their deals with countries of the global south with a component of arms sales. So you have the arms corporate, so you have a country like France, let's say, which produces arms. You have the companies, the corporations of France, who are directly dealing with the government of France. And French foreign policy will definitely include a component of arms purchase by every country to which it gives so-called aid or development benefits. And this has been established by scholarship, and particularly for South Asia, Tom Lansford has established this, because once you have the circulation, there is no way a peaceful South Asia is useful to anybody but the people of South Asia. A peaceful South Asia is a complete waste. If Pakistan and India and Bangladesh and Nepal got together and had a chat, that's the end of a lot of dollars flowing into the coffers of corporations. So who benefits from militarism? It's interesting to see the difference between currently in our country we see this incredible degree of warmongering by those who themselves will not risk their lives. I mean, I know people are, they're being mocked for it also, but there is a huge amount of so-called patriotic, jingoistic war talk by people who will not risk their own lives and who want to send other people's sons to die, and not yet daughters, but sons to die on the borders. For example, there was a huge online petition that asked Modiji to declare war and be willing to bear any sacrifice, he said. He lives in New Jersey, USA. Doubtless in the USA, he is leading the movement for minority rights and the right of Hindus to build temples and practice their religion in equality with Christians. But here he is funding and perhaps not even bothering to fund. He's clicking clicking on war. Yes, yes to war. Now contrast the incredibly asinine warmongering of the media and the general commentary by a lot of people on social media. Look at the difference between that and the reaction of, so I'm just going to move away from feminism for one second to say that sometimes the kind of rationality that feminists exhibit, you don't have to be feminist to recognize that. As we saw with, when I said this a moment ago, when I said that does war really achieve the ends that it sets out to. You don't have to be feminist to understand that often war doesn't do that. But you will see the distinction very clearly this time in the reaction of serving and former armed forces personnel, how they are reacting and how the great patriotic media is reacting. So you have, for example, you must have seen the statement by the CRPF itself, whose men were killed in the recent encounter, in the recent incident, where the CRPF put out advertisement saying, if ordinary Kashmiris are being attacked, please let us know, we stand by them, we will protect them. Now, I'm not sure CRPF is the most trusted entity for Kashmiri civilians, but nevertheless, apparently the ways in which Kashmiri civilians were being attacked by those who claim that Kashmir is ours, this is not something that CRPF wanted to abide by. So they distanced themselves from the attack on civilian Kashmiris, and they said, so even CRPF did that, meaning to say hardly, you know, the key feminist sort of component of the Indian Armed Forces. You have the statement by the former IAF pilot Rajiv Tyagi, who said, stop baying for the blood of our soldiers, because you don't know what war means. I know what war means. We all know what war means. You have the veteran of Kargil, Major Devinder Pal Singh, who wrote in a bemused and astonished way on Facebook about the TV anchor of Zee News, which we in JNU know to be so ethical and so, we are so proud of Zee News for its journalistic ethics. We know all about Zee News. And this anchor of Zee News actually attacked Major Devinder Pal Singh for saying that You don't understand the cost of war. She said to him, have you seen the pictures of Pulwama? If you had seen it, you would have known that revenge is the only solution. And this is to Devinder Pal Singh, who has actually fought in Kargil and risked his life. And he knows what the cost of war is. But sitting in a studio in Delhi, in Zee News, which has, of course, attributed to itself the most nationalist award of the century, of course, she knows better. She knows much better than him what is nationalism and how to be nationalist. He was flabbergasted by this. So the perception of war by those who have to fight it is much more complicated than blind jingoism. And you don't really have to be feminist to see what the cost of war is. So feminists just happen to be rational enough to see that. But you don't, what I'm saying is it's not even that bizarre or that extraordinary to say some of the things that feminists say. So to return to feminist anti-nationalism, anti-militarism, it is necessarily also transnationalist. Peace workers don't observe the same borders that nation states do. I'll come back to this quest of borders later, but now I want to move to the feminist critique of the nation state. This was a very quick attempt to give you a sense of what feminist anti-militarism is. And the second element of this, which is related, is because, as Virginia Woolf said, as a woman, I have no country, there is a critique of the nation state. And there's a large body of feminist scholarship which has argued that legal and social interventions over the 19th and 20th centuries across the globe, intimately and explicitly, across the globe, I should say, particularly in the countries that had experienced colonialism, these kinds of interventions, legal and social interventions, intimately and explicitly tied to the values of modernity, gradually disciplined a range of non-normative sexualities and family arrangements across the world. So what was happening was that colonial modernity was allying with a kind of patriarchal nationalist elite. It was a strange but very common alliance. It's a nationalist elite and it's the colonial values, but they're moving together through colonial modernity to discipline non-normative sexualities and to produce a clean Victorian family unit, which was patriarchal and heterosexual. And you see this in many, many contexts. So there's, for example, a very interesting essay by Malathi D'Alves, Sri Lankan scholar, on the very famous kind of marginalization, invisibilizing of homoerotic desire. All erotic desire is heterosexualized. And the women's movement also, at that point, she says, participated in this project of heterosexualizing love and producing this conjugal unit of heterosexual love. So this is in Iran, and we saw what happened, of course, in Sri Lanka as well. It's equally impossible to engage with what is called sexuality in contemporary India without recognizing its passage through the complexity of the practices that were homogenized under the sign of modernity. So the same thing happens in India. You have a vast subcontinent with multiple forms of social institutions of intimacy, different kinds of family structures. You have the possibility of the polyvalence, multiple gender identities and multiple kinds of sexual desire, even up to the 19th century. And this entire kind of of heterogeneous and unfixed ways in which sexuality was circulating was fixed from the 19th century through legal and social interventions that disciplined a range of non-normative sexualities and family arrangements. You see this in Ruth Vanitha and Salim Kidwai's path-breaking collection, Same Sex Love in India, which says that it's only in the 19th century that a minor homophobic voice that was largely ignored by mainstream society in pre-colonial India becomes a dominant one. Until then, they say that you actually find in all, they study all kinds of texts and they see that the love among men and men, women and women, and other kinds of non-normative love were talked about quite routinely. So you actually find that what happens with, so you have a kind of that you find that earlier forms of sexuality, family, and property arrangements that did not conform to modern bourgeois patriarchal norms were reconstituted to fit these norms by what I call this kind of strange partnership between the nationalist modernizing male elites and the British colonial institutions. They come together to do this. It's very interesting. You have a huge amount of anxiety among the Indian nationalist elites about showing the British that we are actually properly modern, that our very strange customs and sexual practices, which you find so odd being Victorians, I can assure you are a remnant of our past. The modern Indian is not like this. This is the anxiety. The anxiety is to show we are properly masculine and properly feminine. We deserve independence. It's part of, because we are there, we are with you, we are exactly like you. So you have anxieties about homoeroticism, and there's some excellent scholarship in India in different kinds of spheres. And so you find anxieties of homoeroticism. For example, in theater. So when you look at work in historical work on theater, cross-dressing in theater. If you look at the work on cross-dressing, it was very common for men to perform female roles. If you look at the work around that, you actually get a sense of how much anxiety was produced by cross-dressing. Anxiety for Indian nationalists who want to show that we are properly modern and properly masculine and so on. So there's a study of Bengali theater by Rimli Bhattacharya, who shows that it's very interesting. She shows that there was a whole kind of a move in Bengali middle-class literate society to stop the practice of men playing women's roles by saying that, look, it's not real enough. They don't actually look female, and it just looks all wrong. So the question of verisimilitude was raised, that we have to stop this practice of men playing women's roles because they simply don't look female enough. But there are two elements here, which is actually interesting when they say this, because for one thing, as Catherine Hansen has shown in her work on theatre in Western India, what we assume to be the naturalness of gendered appearance is actually a product of socio-historical circumstances. So Catherine Hansen actually shows that female impersonation, far from appearing unnatural, in fact, and I quote her, fashioned a widely circulated standard for female appearance and modified code of feminine conduct. So the men performing women on stage were meant to produce the model for the new emerging bourgeois Indian woman to model her femininity upon. I'll come back to Rimli Bhattacharya's argument in a minute, but remember that the argument that is being made for men not performing female roles is that they just don't look female enough. But Catherine Hansen is saying, on the contrary, in fact, the men who were performing female roles performed femininity in such a way that women were supposed to emulate that. In fact, female viewers were explicitly, so in other contexts, in other articles, female viewers were instructed to model themselves on that transvestite actor. So clearly cross-dressing produced anxieties about what Hansen terms the underlying homoerotic valence that linked the gazes of the hero and male heroine on stage and the impersonator and male spectator in the theater hall. So there's that huge homoerotic charge, which is what is worrying Indian nationalist elites, because here are the British who have Section 377, who have declared that there is only one kind of natural love and only that kind of love is modern and proper, and here are Indians mixing up genders all over the place. So what is interesting from what Rimli Bhattacharya is pointing out is that on the one hand you are saying that they just don't look female enough, and on the other hand the same Bengali journals are talking about You know, this is also not proper because young boys in the audience are attracted to these men playing women, and that creates all kinds of problems. But if they don't look like women, what is your problem? So either they look too much like women, or they don't look like women enough, or what, right? So this huge amount of work on cross-dressing in Indian theatre shows how the nationalist elite was concerned to build up a proper nation state with a proper masculine body, a proper feminine body, with the female learning to be female, the male learning to be male, etc. So the question that really arises is about patriarchal and heteronormative sources of modern identity. The emergence of the modern citizen in place of the feudal subject, many centuries ago in Europe and gradually all over the globe, is generally understood to have been an emancipatory development, precisely because this identity was unmarked by status, because you were no longer a feudal serf, everybody is a citizen, it's unmarked, and so on. So this was seen as a progressive, and indeed it is, and we need to claim it as such, and so on. But feminist scholarship and radical scholarship in general has demonstrated that it was never unmarked. That this category of citizen, basically through the erasure of women and working class men and non-whites, was therefore marked as male, upper caste, or white, or whatever the dominant identity was. More significantly, the gendering of citizenship requires us to question and to challenge the fact that citizenship is produced and mediated by the heterosexual patriarchal family. So the link, in case you're wondering where I'm going, is that this is part of the argument, the second part of the argument, that feminists have a critique of the nation state as such. And the reason why feminists have a critique, there are many reasons. And one of the key reasons is that the nation state is based, its identity is based on the heterosexual patriarchal family, which is produced in the course of the nationalist struggles using the language of modernity and by erasing multiple non-normative forms of sexualities. That's the argument we're working with. So citizenship is produced and mediated by the heterosexual patriarchal family. So let me take just one example. There was a Supreme Court judgment in 2005, which ruled that a child inherits the father's caste. Now, what was this context? The judgment was holding illegal the election of an upper caste man's daughter from a constituency reserved for a candidate belonging to scheduled tribes. Now, this woman, Shobha Haimavati Devi, won the election. The election was challenged by those who lost on the grounds that she's not an ST person, and so she should not have been contesting from the seat reserved for STs. And in her petition defending her election, she said that her father had not legally married her mother, who was from the scheduled caste, a particular scheduled tribe. He had abandoned her and his children by her, and therefore Shobha Devi was brought up by her mother in her community, and so she should be considered to have inherited her mother's caste. This was the argument. And the justices of the Supreme Court were not at all impressed by this reasoning, and they expressed their quote-unquote dismay that what they said was, we are dismayed that a politician in her bid for political office would stoop so low as to brand her five siblings and herself illegitimate and her mother a concubine. So this is what they heard. Is that interesting? She's telling them that my father never married my mother. We were brought up in my community, not by the upper caste father's community. And therefore, I have actually inherited my mother's caste. The judges here, bastard, illegitimacy. Promiscuous woman, had sex outside marriage, had five children outside marriage. Their patriarchal years translate everything into this. And they're just horrified that someone can proudly stand up there and say, my father never married my mother, right? So there are implicit assumptions at play in this judgment. One, that illegitimacy is something that any respectable, in quotes, illegitimacy is something that any respectable person would try to hide. So a declaration of illegitimacy could only be a ploy to hold office. Two, the three upper caste judges, the three upper caste judges constituting the bench seem to share the general upper caste anti-affirmative action understanding in India that a scheduled caste or tribe identity is an undeserved advantage and it should be limited as far as possible. So while the judgment has the potential equally to be read as, now, this, you can read this judgment in another way. Rather than saying that it established that a child inherits her father's caste, it could be seen as recognizing women's rights in common law marriage and their rights to, therefore, their common law meaning no legal marriage, but to your partner. So therefore, it should establish the woman's right then to her partner's property and everything, right? It should really be recognizing women's rights in common law marriage and as legitimizing intercaste marriage, but instead it becomes a precedent for naturalizing caste identity passed on through patriarchy. It is evident that the family as it exists, the only form in which it is allowed to exist in most parts of the world, the heterosexual patriarchal family, is key to maintaining social stability, property relations, nation and community. Caste, race, community identity are all produced through birth and traced through the father. But so too, in most cases, is the very modern identity of citizenship. The purity of these identities, of these social formations, and of the existing regime of property relations is thus dependent on a particular form of family which feminists are critical of. And therefore, they are critical of the nation state, which requires this form of the family to be kept in place. Now, it is important to note, and I won't go into this in much detail, but it is important to note that it is possible for a certain kind of gay-lesbian politics to seek inclusion within the nation. It's not necessary that all queer politics is also critical of the nation state. It is possible, and this has been argued by Jasbir Puar in the context of Israeli gay lesbian politics, which is very Israeli nationalist, very Zionist, and which excludes and accepts the occupation of Palestine. But it's also true in India for Jasbir Puar calls this homo nationalism, and it's also true in India that there is a relatively minor strand in the sense that it's a very visible, very well-known, very brave gay activist who has been out since forever, one of the first, Ashok Rao Kavi, one of the first gay men to be out in India. So yes, his contribution to the LGBT movement is unquestioned. Nevertheless, he articulates a Hindu nationalist position very clearly. So there was a raid on two NGOs that work on AIDS, police raid in Lucknow, and then they were raided, NAS and Bharosa, and it was claimed that they were circulating pornographic material, etc. So there was a police raid. And then there were activists gathered together, queer and feminist activists gathered together to condemn this raid, and at that point there was an exchange between Ashok Rao Kavi and other activists. And he highlighted the fact that this is very old. This situation is about at least 10. This exchange is at least 10 years old. But it's interesting to simply place as a historical possibility of one kind of. So when I say patriarchal heterosexual family and heteronormativity as the cornerstone of the Indian nation, I'm trying to say we should be alert to the fact that can be claimed by other identities which are not heteronormative themselves. So what he does is, Ashok Rao Kavi highlighted the fact that Bharosa and Naz were run by Muslims. In addition, he reproduced a report from Times of India, which he endorsed, based on an Intelligence Bureau report of 1998, in which the IB had tipped off the government that the gay culture spreading its roots in part of Uttar Pradesh was funded by international organizations based in Canada and Europe, which has a chunk of Pakistani nationals residing there. So who have you left out? Nobody. The whites, the West, the Paschatya Sanskriti, and the Pakistanis. In one fell swoop, the IB put all of these together as generating gay culture in India. So what does Ashok Rao Kavi do? Instead of going ha 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 ha, he actually cites that report. And he justifies it. I mean, he accepts it. And he goes on to point out that indeed the partner NGOs of NAS Foundation International were present in some very strategic towns and cities in India. Which are these strategic towns and cities? Chennai is the capital of Dravidian subnationalism with close ties to LTTE in Sri Lanka. And he mentions many other cities which all are strategic, either because they are Muslim populations or something like this. Kavi also emphasized what he evidently considered a damning fact regarding statements by Amnesty London and Eaglehawk, which is the international gay lesbian, it's one of the big gay lesbian international fronts. So he, Ashok Rao Kavi says that the statements by Amnesty and Eaglehawk on the raid on Bharosa, they are both also headed by Muslims. So when you, so in other words, he, so this letter must be read in conjunction with his general views, which were evident in several other public pronouncements. What Kavi is concerned, was concerned with, is inclusion within the Hindu nation for LGBT people. He stands for a tolerant India, which however he believed is tolerant only because of its Hindu majority. Consequently, he denounced the groups that attacked fire. He did not accept the attack on the film fire that was attacked by Hindu right-wing groups. He did not accept that attack. And he wrote an open letter to the chief of RSS at that time, pleading for the RSS, pleading, he used this word, to stop the campaign against gay men and lesbians as a foreign lifestyle issue. He argued that unlike Islam and Christianity, Hindu texts have never considered homosexuality to be a sin, and the letter concludes, we will never accept second-class citizenship and be pushed into darkness again. He means gay and lesbian people, but he makes in his no reference in this letter to the citizenship rights of minority communities, which are the target of primary target of RSS attacks, because the Muslim is the eternal outsider in that picture. So now, so there is a kind of, so he does, this is not a very, you know, very, because he's very visible and he is one of the very famous and brave people of the movement, one refers to this, but it's not a very strong strand in Indian feminist and queer politics. The objective of a feminist and queer politics of radical transformation cannot simply be that of seeking full citizenship within the nation. For some other group will always be excluded by a nation. This is why any queer feminism has to be really troubled by the idea of the nation state, because the nation state is precisely not about the whole world. The nation state is precisely about saying us and them. There has, otherwise there's no nation state. Then there's only one big universe, right? The political agenda in the US of challenging the don't ask, don't, there was that don't ask, don't tell policy for the US Army and for gay and lesbian women in the armed forces. And there was a huge campaign that they wanted to be recruited into the American armed forces, and they were fighting against this don't ask, don't tell policy because they wanted to be recruited as out gay people. But you can actually see a similar logic to that of Ashok Rao Kavi's operating here, seeking full citizenship within the American nation, but into America's armed forces, which have a certain role to play in the world, right? If all identities, including that of modern citizenship, are derived from patriarchal institutions establishing compulsory heterosexuality, is any feminist or queer critique of the contemporary, whether of capitalism, racism or casteism, imperialism or patriarchy, possible without questioning the three, all three, the family, national boundaries and heteronormativity? Now, how does one counter the nation? It's important to counter the nation state, and feminists do that in different kinds of ways. So when you counter the nation, it has to be made very clear that a queer feminist countering of the nation is different from a post-nationalism used in two senses. One kind of use of the notion of post-nationalism comes from corporate capital, right, which wants to dissolve all borders for capital but retain all borders for labor. So there's a kind of there's one kind of post-nationalism which says enough of nation states that are keeping, that are holding up the free flow of capital and let capital flow freely. That is one kind of post-nationalism. The other kind of post-nationalism comes from a different perspective, a kind of liberal humanist perspective like that of, for example, Habermas. Habermas celebrates global universalism. But that too has its problems because, as I said, a universal citizen is always actually marked. The universal citizen is assumed to be white male, and any other kind of demand is seen as putting difference into that space. So the universal citizen is not very useful either. So when we talk about post-national, I'm really referring to a different kind of post-nationalism from below and from above as well. It's a different kind of post-nationalism which sidesteps, in a way, the nation state. So what I mean is that this kind of a post-nationalism has to recognize that the notion of... All right. So scholar Amalia Zeev, in a study of the group, suggests that black laundry tied together sexual deviance and national deviance with slogans like free condoms, free Palestine, bull dykes, not missile strikes, transgender, not transfer. Transfer was the forced deportation of Palestinians. So through these kinds of slogans, and they're not just slogans, they're talking about actual activism and resisting the Israeli state, it breaks down the hierarchies of nation and sex, challenging queer politics with anti-occupation politics and anti-occupation politics with queer politics. Zeev argues that through the twin strategies of national betrayal and sexual depravity, black laundry deliberately situated itself outside the discursive community of Israel-Palestine, as well as hetero-homosexual. You can also have interesting such interesting moments from the diasporic location. Shall I take another 5 minutes?
Yes, you can take.
So the diasporic location is also one that offers very interesting strategies of over the nation. So sometime in the 90s, there was a controversy in the US because of a group called SALGA, South Asian Lesbian and Gay Association. So what happened in the US is the Federation of Indian Associations, a private organization dominated by Indian businessmen in the US, they have a march on Indian Independence Day. There's a parade on Indian Independence Day in New York. But this Federation of Indian Associations refused permission for years to SALGA to march in the Indian Independence Day parade. So SALGA was not allowed to march in the parade, but nor was SAKHI. SAKHI was an organization that addressed the question of domestic violence against women in the South Asian community. So what happens with SAKHI and SALGA is that they disrupt this narrative of the homogenous nation state. Because they are talking about domestic violence inside South Asian families, they are talking about gay and lesbian South Asians, right? So what is happening is that SALGA and SAKHI threaten to disrupt narratives of the Indian nations in two crucial ways. One, they insisted on the South Asian identity, which would have meant that, oh, that is another issue. I forgot this part. Actually, as I'm noticing what I wrote, I suddenly remembered that this is a point I should have made first of all, that they insisted on South Asian identity. Now, what does a South Asian identity mean in the US? That on Indian Independence Day, Pakistanis and Bangladeshis are marching in the parade. You see, this is why the nation state can never be an inclusive. It is ridiculous the way the Hindu right goes on saying Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, and they can't even pronounce it correctly. Most of them know no Sanskrit. I know more Sanskrit than many of them, I can tell you. So they keep saying Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, but Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam means the entire universe is one country, and of course it is one family, and of course, except for Pakistanis, Muslims, Christians, Northeastern, what utter nonsense is this, right? So South Asia, the insistence on the South Asian identity meant that Bangladeshis and Pakistanis would have marched in the Indian parade. Then you have the gay and lesbian identity, and then you have the disjunctures within the great Indian family, which SAKHI was pointing to. So after sustained pressure, eventually SAKHI was allowed to join, but SALGA had to carry on for much longer, struggling for much longer. So that struggle is actually very interesting, and it can only happen in the diasporic location where the idea of India is being reworked in these ways, and that's a certain kind of interesting post-national politics, the insistence on a South Asian identity inside the India space. Now, there is, of course, the other dimension of post-national politics, which is under the nation, which is less obvious as a strategy because it does not assume the prior existence of the nation. More significantly, its subversive edge may lie in the exact opposite of what animates the position of over the nation, which is the strategy of exit and movement across borders, right? Over the nation, post-nationalism over the nation is talking about crossing borders and exit and movement. But I think, I'm suggesting that an under-the-nation strategy is, it may be animated by the opposite. The interrogation of the nation from under may involve rather the refusal to move. As for example, in the struggles against big dams or mining operations that involve massive relocation of populations, and they say, hum nahi hatenge, bandh nahi badhega, right? Which was one of NBA's slogans, and they just remain there, the water's going over their heads. You've seen the incredible pictures of Jal Samadhi, which the villagers across the Narmada Basin have undertaken. So it's a refusal to move. Or if you look at Patthalgadi, the Patthalgadi, which is actually citing the constitution and refusing officers of the Indian, officials of the Indian state entry, it's not movement, it is we remain here, right? So that's an interesting under the nation strategy, I think. And from the perspective of counter-heteronormative politics, this dimension may involve claiming histories that run parallel to and do not intersect with the nation, or claiming forms of family and kinship that produce identity that are splintered and fluid, that resist inclusion into larger formations. So, for example, a startling moment denormalizing the idea of family is produced when many hijras who have contested elections claim that precisely because they cannot have children, they will be less selfish and corrupt. This is actually an argument that has been made in political campaigns, that so families as being corrupt, selfish, and non-collective, and someone who's freed of the tyranny of the family being less selfish and corrupt. Or sex workers refusing to shift their work premises in the face of intimidation by local communities forces a recognition of the imbrication of sex work in everyday life. So I'm calling this the politics of refusal, which implies the simultaneous transformation through practices of everyday life of the place where you insist on staying. So it seems to me that the potential of this is enormous and the imaginative horizons are expansive. Let me conclude with one imaginative feminist, anti-militarist, anti-nation-state initiative in the U.S. In 2005, when the U.S. was swept by anti-war protests, some very strange people lined up to be recruited to the U.S. Armed Forces at the Times Square Recruiting Center in New York. 18 women aged 59 to 91, calling themselves Grannies for Peace. They said they wanted to sign up and replace younger soldiers. They were not, of course, allowed to enter the recruiting station, so they sat quietly outside. Many carried canes, one was legally blind, and one moved with a walker. They were handcuffed and jailed for 4 hours on charge of obstructing the entrance to the center. Later, after a 6-day trial, they were found not guilty because the judge ruled that they had left sufficient space for entry. We understand this, how to do this, right? Sufficient space for entry. One of them, asked by a prosecutor during the trial what she thought she could do in the army, she answered straight-faced, "I do have a skill set. I could have been used to deploy equipment." On being pushed to state that she really was prepared to go to war, she said, "I was totally prepared. I'd just gotten divorced. I was ready." At this, the other grannies on trial laughed out loud, and the judge, it is reported, blushed. The morning after they were acquitted, along with a sister group in Arizona called the Raging Grannies of Tucson, they led an anti-war rally down Broadway. I was there. Those lining the road went wild. A roar went up. Grannies, grannies, grannies. Isn't that a more inspiring chant than the name of any country on this earth? Thank you.